spazionare nel dolorato concupiscite, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Esultate, Deo di Dio nostro, jubilate, Deo Iacob. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto. Sicut erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen. Quas in modo genit in pacte, alleluia. Spazionare nel dolorato concupiscite, alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie
eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Gloria in excelsis. per omnia saecula saeculorum. Ioannis apostolis habissime omnibus est ex Deo vincit mundum et eges victoria quae vincit mundum et fides nostra quis est qui vincit mundum nisi qui quinigonium et Iesus et Filius Dei. Iges qui veni per aquam et sanguinem Iesus Christus, non in aqua solum, sed in aqua et sanguinem. Et Spiritus et Spirit est vivificado quoniam Christus et veritas. Quoniam troes ubi testimonium dant in cielo, Pade verbum et Spiritus Sanctus et hic presum nomen sum. Et res ubi testimonium dat in terra, Spiritus et aqua et sanguis et hic presum nomen sum. Si testimonium omnium accipimus testimonium Dei maius est, quoni hoc est testimonium Dei, quam maius est, quoni testificabis est Dei filios suum. Qui credit in filium Dei, habet testimonium Dei in se.
Padel ego vitolos, ecum dixit et insufflabit et dixit eis. Accipite Spiritum Sanctum, forme miserere peccata regni junto eis, et forme de nuveris eis retenta sum. Omnes autem numero sexto et decim qui dicit ut dedimus, non erat cum est quando veniet sos. Dixerunt ego ei alii discipuli, pedimus Dominum. Ille autem dixit eis, dixit videre manibus eius fixum laborum, et vitam digitum eme laucum clavorum. Et vita manum eme laudo Deus non creiam. Et post dies octum itineram eram discipuli eius intus, et Thomas copeis. Veni Iesus clianum est clausus est sedem in medio, et dixit vas vobis. Deine dicit omne, digitum tuum muge vire manos meas, et ave manum tuve mite in lactus meum, et nolies incredulus et fidelis. Responde Thomas et dixit ei, Dominus meus et Deus meus. Dixit ei, Iesus, quia vidissime Thomas credidis, beati qui non videro ne crederò. Nulla qui veralia signe fede Iesus in conspetto discipulorum suorum, quae non sunt scripti in libro hoc. Hoc ad inscripto sunt occritaris qui in Iesus et Christus Filius Dei, et occredentes vitam abeatis in nomine Eius. The epistle for today, Lord's Sunday, the first Sunday after Easter, is taken from the first letter of the Apostle St. John. Dearly beloved, whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory which overcometh the world, our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he that came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. Not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit which testifieth that Christ is the truth. And there are three who give testimony in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And there are three that give testimony on earth, the Spirit, and the water, and the blood. And these three are one. If we receive the testimony of men, the testimony of God is greater. For this is the testimony of God which is greater, because he hath testified of his Son. He that believeth in the Son of God hath the testimony of God in himself. And the Holy Gospel is taken from the Gospel according to St. John. At that time, when it was late that same day, the first of the week, and the doors were shut, where the disciples were gathered together for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in the midst and said to them, "Peace be to you." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples therefore were glad when they saw the Lord. He said therefore to them again, "Peace be to you. As the Father hath sent me, I also send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them, and he said to them, "Receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whose sins you shall forgive, they are forgiven them. And whose sins you shall retain, they are retained." Now Thomas, one of the 12, who was called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the place of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." And after 8 days, again his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Jesus cometh, the doors being shut, and stood in the midst, and said, "Peace be to you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put in thy finger hither, and see my hands, and bring hither thy hand, and put it into my side, and be not incredulous, but believing." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus saith to him, "Because thou hast seen me, Thomas, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen and have believed." Many other signs also did Jesus in the sight of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Just a couple of announcements. First of all, a reminder that the catechism classes have started again. They started today and will continue every Sunday between the two masses for children and for adults as usual. Reminder that tomorrow is the Feast of the Annunciation of the Blessed Virgin Mary, transferred from the 25th of March because it fell during Holy Week this year. And so consequently, we'll have a high mass tomorrow morning, 7:15, for the Annunciation to the Blessed Virgin Mary, also 11:25 mass. The school resumes on Tuesday. Reminder, we have parent-teacher meetings on Friday. We have the April issue of the Nova et Vetera magazine at the back of the church. You please feel free to take as many copies as you would like to distribute. Finally, the boys have complained that we have girls' camps, but not a boys' camp. So we are arranging a boys' camp, which will take place during the 5-day break in the middle of this term, from the 27th of April to the 1st of May. There's a flyer on the bulletin board and other flyers available that explain what we plan to do during this boys' camp. Only 20 boys will be allowed to come. The first 20 in will be accepted, then afterwards it will be too late. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. He was born of God, overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, our faith. Those words sound strange to those of us who know many Catholics who have the Catholic faith, but yet the world has overcome them. They have not overcome the world at all. They follow the way of the world. They seek for the pleasures and the delights and the money and the advancement of the prosperity of the world and forget about God and commit sins as if it was not a big deal. How can we say then that it's our faith which overcomes the world? What do we mean by this? What is this faith that overcomes the world? You see, it's not simply the fact of having the faith, which is enough to overcome the world. The faith is the adhesion of our intellect to divinely revealed truth, to accept the truths of our catechism have been revealed by God. If we were to live according to those truths, we would overcome the world. But it's perfectly possible to have the faith and not live in accordance with the faith, to live a double life, a life in compartments. A compartment for religion, a compartment for my friends, a compartment for my work, a compartment for my entertainment, and they're all separate compartments in my life, and they don't mix. And my life is split, schizophrenic, divided. And this is what enables the world to overcome us. The key, then, for our faith to overcome the world is to unite those compartments of my life into one. That it is that my faith might be that vital inspiration which directs the whole of my life, all that I think and do. It's what we found, what we heard in the end of today's gospel, when St. John tells us that embracing this faith, we might have life in his name, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. That divine life, which is the fruit of living the faith. It's something we can reflect upon. How is it that the faith, the truths of faith, might influence, direct, govern, unite my life into one. That all of my life might be directed to the honor and glory of Almighty God. So often we think, my business is to make money. It's got nothing to do with religion. My friends, they are my acquaintances. I have fun with them. It's got nothing to do with religion. My entertainments, my movies, internet, things I like to do, vacations, has nothing to do with religion, nothing to do with God. And this is the problem. Sacred Scripture says, all that you do, whether in word or in work, do all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so the faith must penetrate our business dealings. It's not just to make money. We're serving God. We're helping our fellow man. We're providing a service. We're honest and truthful in all that we say. We never cheat or take advantage of people. This is living our faith. If we work for an employer, we consider that what work we do for the honor and glory of God, not just to get my income. I do the best that I can, not to impress, but to show that I love God, for whom I work, and who has given me this function of working to make up for my sins. If I'm an employer and I have others working for me, I consider the good of those souls. How can I practice charity and kindness, give them a just salary, help them to love God more, give them the means to live their life on earth for heaven? If I have friends, what will I speak to my friends about? Silly things, trivial things, how people dress, what people say? No, I will talk about important things, the things that matter. How to practice virtue, how to be good, how to practice the corporal and spiritual works of mercy, how to love and help out, how to enjoy the presence of God together, how to keep the faith. That's why, if I'm living my faith, my friends will know it. They'll experience it. They'll see what I really care about from the things that I say. My entertainments. What do I seek for in my entertainments? Do I have a horror of immorality and divorce and violence and hatred, as you see in all the movies which entertain people? A horror for evil comes from having the spirit of faith. We have a disgust when we see in people's entertainment envy, violence, cheating, in sports and games and things like that as well. The faith concerns the things that really matter in life and that must direct everything. Our whole way of thinking is for Almighty God, for His honor and glory. And that's how it is that our faith vanquishes the world. And we read in the gospel how many times it is that our divine Savior asked faith. When He performed miracles, He asked for faith. Remember the centurion of whom He said, "I have not seen such great faith in all Israel." He asked Him to cure his boy, said, "Don't come to my house, you don't have to. Lord, I am not worthy that thou should come under my roof. But just say the word, and my servant will be healed," he says. What faith! Or the Canaanite woman who wanted to be healed, and he said, "I don't give the food of the children to strangers." And she says, "No, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the table. Heal me." And he did, admiring the great faith of that woman. The lepers who came to be cleansed of their leprosy, and he asked them if they had faith. The two blind men who came to be cured of their blindness, and he said, "Let it be done unto you according to your faith." But you notice that every time he praises the faith, for example, the woman with an issue of blood, been for 12 years, and she kicks up behind him and wants to touch the hem of his garment. And he notices it and says, "Let it be done unto you according to your faith." And she was healed at that moment. Every time, every event, Jesus asked for faith. But what is this faith he asked for? It's not just simply believing that Jesus is God. It's faith combined with the awareness that He loves us and He wants to help us and we trust in His help. It's what we call confidence. Confidence is the living of the faith in Christ together with His love for us. Having that faith that He always is there to help us. That's a real way in which we can live our faith, is have confidence at every moment in divine providence, that God is watching after us, in the love which Jesus showed us when He came upon this earth. This confidence is fundamental. And that's the faith that our divine Savior praises. Not just the faith which believes with the mind, but which governs our daily actions with confidence in Almighty God. In fact, that's the whole point of devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus. And when our divine Savior appeared to St. Margaret Mary, what did He say to her, amongst many other things? "Have a boundless confidence in my mercy, and whatever you ask, having faith, I will grant it to you all the graces and everything you need. Just admit your weakness and have confidence in my mercy." And that's why there's a very simple prayer to the Sacred Heart of Jesus, which is the expression of our faith and our confidence in God, which we should repeat constantly. "O Sacred Heart of Jesus, I trust in Thee." Simply to repeat that. "O Sacred Heart, I trust in Thee. I have confidence. I give myself to You. I place myself into Your hands." And this confidence is the way in which we can live our faith on a day-to-day basis and vanquish the world. Confidence that is despite our own weakness, despite our own failings, despite our own sins. We see this admirably expressed in the writings and in the life of St. Therese of the Child Jesus. This young Carmelite nun who died at the age of 24 from tuberculosis became a saint in 9 years of religious life. And her teaching, which is so fundamental, is how to live the faith by confidence in Almighty God, in our divine Savior, in our Lord Jesus Christ. Everybody knows that her little way, as she called it, little way of spiritual childhood, was but the application of the gospel, the words of the gospel, which St. Matthew tells us are very simple. Unless you humble yourself and become as a little child, you cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. And why does our Lord say that? Because the little child has confidence in his Father and abandoned himself into his Father's hands. And so must we be with Almighty God. And this is precisely what St. Teresa of the Child Jesus developed in her life in particular. We read about it in her autobiography. How she tells the story of her spiritual struggle, which was to unite together humility and confidence. Those two together make then a life of faith. Humility, acknowledging my weakness, my littleness, my inability by myself to do good, to love God, to keep God's commandments. I'm weak, I'm a sinner, I fail many times. I know it. I know myself. I know what I would be like if it were not for the grace of God. But humility by itself is not enough. St. Teresa the Child Jesus was audacious. She wanted to do everything for everybody and save souls. And though she never left her convent, to be a true missionary. How did she have this audacity to think that weak, little, as she knew herself to be, she could make such a difference and send roses from heaven, graces over the whole surface of the earth, because of her confidence? And that is the remarkable aspect of St. Teresa's life. It's the joining together, the complementarity of humility and confidence. We see that so clearly in her life. And she writes, "Yes, I know my faults. I know my weaknesses. I know my failings. And I tell all of them to my divine Lord and Savior. I don't hide anything from him. And it's because of that, because I'm so little, that I can place my hand in his, and I have utter confidence that he will take me, and he will take me to heaven." That's why she had confidence she could be a saint, because of God's grace. And she felt that none of her weaknesses and failings would be an obstacle so long as she told him about them to his grace. And it's so true. When she was at the age of 22, appointed to be novice mistress. And the novice mistress in the Carmelite convent has to give spiritual talks to the novices and tell them about the spiritual life. And she says, and she writes down in her autobiography, "But what can I do? What can I say? I'm nothing. I couldn't say anything. Well, how am I supposed to fulfill that function?" So she said, "I said to Jesus, I give myself entirely into your hands. I can't do anything by myself. I don't know what to say. Just pour into my hands your graces, your thoughts, your insights, and let them pass as treasures through me." And that's exactly what happened. And she was able to be a beautiful mistress to the nuns, teaching them how to follow that little way of humility and confidence to our divine Savior. And that is the simple thing that we can all do to live our faith on a daily basis. You don't have to be great or strong. You don't have to be a theologian. You don't have to know even all your catechism totally well. All you have to do is want to live in total confidence and dependence upon Almighty God. Which means, when we have troubles and difficulties and pains and hardships, everything into God's hands. Sacred Heart of Jesus, I trust in thee. I place everything in his hands. I have temptations and difficulties. St. Teresa, the Child Jesus, had that too. She had times of great obscurity and temptations against the faith, and this great darkness came over her as if she didn't know where she was going. But what did she do? She saw this as a test to make an act of confidence, to give herself in blind faith to her divine Savior and Lord, to our Lord Himself. And she did that, and He pulled her through, and she came through with great merit through those trials and difficulties, which are part of the purification of her faith and of her soul. We will likewise have trials, difficulties, temptations, pains, sicknesses, and hardships. And in such moments, that is the time to express our confidence to Almighty God, to give Him ourselves, to offer ourselves to Him, to abandon ourselves. There, we find the key to the supernatural. And that we can all do. When we have difficult decisions to make, when we have to decide, how am I going to work or live, or decide who are my friends going to be and what am I going to do, how am I going to have fun, into Thy hands we repeat with Jesus, I commend my spirit. We give everything into God's hands. We want to do His holy will. We know that we're little, we have confidence. It's the key then to living our faith. And so it's the key to the victory. As St. Paul says, having our eyes fixed on Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who, about to suffer the cross, despised its shame, looking up towards everlasting life. His example for us. He gave Himself into His Father's hands on the cross. He bore our weakness. He had total confidence. And so let's turn to Him, who teaches us how to live by faith and its confidence, which is the practical way to do so. And that confidence is the joyful awareness of God's will, of God's goodness, of God's love, of God's help at every moment for our souls. And that will give us the spirit of prayer, which is how we live our faith. You don't have to pray all the time. You don't have to be a monk or a nun to have the spirit of prayer which leads to confidence. You have to have this submission to God's holy will. And when things happen, into Thy hands, I trust in Thee, I'm all Thine, give ourselves to Him. I don't know what to do, You do, take charge. Confidence is the key. And it gives great peace of soul, joy in the midst of sufferings. It's what makes, as Jesus said, the burden of His cross light and easy to bear. It's that confidence which He urges us to have at every instant. And then we have the reward. We read in the book of the Apocalypse how it is that our divine Savior says to the angel of Smyrna, and He promises the church of Smyrna in Asia Minor great sufferings and imprisonment. But He says, but be you faithful and I will give you the crown of life. Be faithful. Be faithful to keeping the faith, living the faith, and we'll receive the crown of life everlasting. So let's ask the Blessed Virgin Mary to obtain that grace for us, of living our faith, of having a strong faith in the depth of our hearts, so that we can always trust in God and trust in Jesus' mercy, trust in His passion, trust in His graces, beg His help, admit our weakness, have that littleness in the depth of our souls, and then we will live our faith, and we will have that faith which conquers the world, and the pride and the selfishness of the world will have no impact upon us whatsoever, nor the vanity of the things it seeks after, because we will have vanquished. And we will not be confounded because we have trusted in the Lord our God, as the Psalms say. May our Heavenly Queen obtain that grace for all of us. She is our Lady of Holy Hope. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Orate, frate, Tatăl omnipotente,
Amen.
Thank you.
Misteriato veste omnipotente et mystificatis veste producat vos ad vitam aeternam. Indulgentiam absolutiam et remissiam peccatorum vesto contigo ad vobis omnipotente misericos Dominus. Ecce Agnus Dei, ecce qui tollit peccato mundi. Domine nostrum dignus, surita esse tectum meum, sed adjudic vero esse nabitur anima mea. Domine nostrum dignus, surita esse tectum meum, sed adjudic vero esse nabitur anima mea. Domine nostrum dignus, surita esse tectum meum, se tanto ti vero e se n'abito animo. Thank you.
Thank you.
Dominus vobiscum. Quae pro revelationis nostrum unum in conduisti, et praeses novis remedium est efficias et potuum, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum virium tuum, qui te convivere regnar in unitate Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Holy name pledge. Blessed be God. The Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. I profess publicly my belief that our Lord Jesus Christ is the Son of God, made man for the salvation of mankind. I recognize his divine authority. And believe that all power on earth, civil and religious, comes from him. All of a constituted authority, I respect and promise to obey. May the God of justice guide the minds and uphold the hands of those vested with his power. May the God of might break asunder the bonds of those met together against the Lord and against his Christ. In honor of his divine name, I pledge myself against perjury, blasphemy, profanity, and obscene speech.
Praise be the name of God.
And blessed be the name of his divine Son.
And blessed be the name of his divine Son.
Now and forever.
Amen.